Welcome to Rajendra Tandon videos, continuing with the chapters on Vidura Niti. We take up chapter 4, in which Vidur very deftly explains how reconciliation, as he is advocating, is dharma when practiced by noble families, and how it leads to prosperity and wealth accumulation as well. He starts with a story, a conversation between Dattatreya and the gods he was worshipping. Maharshi Dattatreya was wandering as a royal swan, Paramahansa. The gods asked him, "We are unable to gauge your reality just by looking at you. We believe that you are learned in scriptures, wise and a composed person. Say a few learned words to us." The Hansa replied, "Devatas, I have learnt that a person's duty lies in being composed, in control of senses and the mind, and in following the truth and the dharma. Shedding all prejudices, he should treat everyone equally whether he likes him or not. He should not retort to foul words with expletives. Controlling his anger, the person who forgives the guilty reduces him to nothingness." What an idea! When you have forgiven the guilty, you have reduced him to shunya, zero, nothingness. You don't provide him with any reason to attack you again. Continuing, Dattatreya said, "A noble person must not insult another nor abuse him. He must not betray a friend nor serve another who is mean. He should not be arrogant nor of a loose moral character. He must avoid use of angry, harsh and unkind words." Basically, Vidur is telling Dhritarashtra that his son, with his brothers as well as with his advisors like Karan and Shakuni, is conducting himself in a foul fashion. The qualities which have been enumerated just above do not exist in him and his friends. The Hansa, the Paramahansa, says, "Harsh and unkind words hurt the listener in the core of his heart. A righteous person should give up the use of harsh words forever. Like cloth taking on the color of a dye in which it is soaked, a noble person is adversely affected if he renders service to or keeps the company of an evil person, a fraudulent tapasvi or a thief. It is said that silence is better than speech. However, the second virtue of speech is telling the truth, the first being silence." What a formation! Silence is better than speech, but if you speak, you must speak truth alone. Use of pleasant words is the third desirable attribute of speech. Fourthly, speaking according to dharma makes even pleasant words sound better. Wah, wah. A human being takes on the color of the company he keeps or of those he serves. He can mold himself according to his will as well. A man is freed from the desires he wants to eschew or take his mind off from. Once completely detached, he is unaffected by sorrow. He moves beyond happiness and sorrow, who is neither vanquished nor has a desire to overcome another. who is not inimical to anyone, who does not like to hurt others, and who looks at infamy and aplomb with equanimity. These are attributes later discussed in Gita as well. So you can say, this is a foretaste of the sermon which we are going to have in Gita, in Mahabharata, on which I have already made 22 videos. He is superior who wishes everyone well, who never nurses an ill will for anyone else, who is truthful and soft-spoken, and who has conquered his senses. At this stage, Dhritarashtra intervenes and says, Vidur, I see that devatas acknowledge in dharma and earth, and they also want to be friends with persons from families of status. Who are these families of status? Vidur replies, those families are superior to others, the members of which have the following attributes: meditation or penance, subjugation of senses, study of the Vedas, performance of yajna, holy matrimonial alliances, distribution of grains in charity all the time, and noble conduct. The families of repute are never lax in their morals. Their young members do not cause pain to their parents and their shortcomings with their shortcomings. Such families, says Vidur, willingly follow the path of dharma. And those families who do not maintain a high moral character cannot be counted among the nobility. Again, he is referring to Dhurishtar. Duryodhan and his friends. The families who have high moral conduct gain prestige in this world. Take care that you do not deviate from the path of righteous conduct. Wealth is transitory. It comes and goes. A virtuous man, even though reduced to penury, is not considered a pauper. However, says Vidur, the one who has strayed from the path of virtue is diminished for good. Vrittam yatnena sanraksed vittameti cha yati cha akshino vittatah akshino vrittatastu hatohrita. These ideas being discussed are not for nothing. They are all practical ideas. They can be acted upon to make our life happier. And Vidur is telling Dhritarashtra that he should act upon these principles so that he is happy and his progeny is happy. Arguing as to how a man can gain artha, which means wealth, Vidur says, an ignorant man, a man who changes his mind all the time, or a man who is ensnared by his lustful senses, cannot attain artha. His objective, his desires, his riches. He is like a hansa which hovers around a lake that has dried, but never steps into it. An evil man's temperament is fickle like that of a cloud. He gets angry for no reason. My brother, honor a friend, whether he is rich or a pauper. Making no demand on friends, one ought not to look forward to material benefits from them. Do not grieve because it does not beget what you aspire to. Grief merely brings bodily suffering and pleases your enemies. Sukham cha dukham cha bhava bhavau cha labha labhau maranam jivitam cha pariyayashah sarvamete sprashanti tasmad dhiro na cha krishnen shochet. Joy and sorrow. Listen to these words carefully. Joy and sorrow, creation and destruction, profit or loss, birth or death are a part of every life cycle. Hence, a composed person should neither rejoice in nor mourn their occurrence. Our six senses are fickle. When these perceptions recklessly indulge in a certain deed, discretion is correspondingly extinguished. It's like water leaking out of a pot with a hole. Here Dhritarashtra interrupts. He's admitting that he has committed mistakes. He says, I have treated Yudhishthira deviously. He is bound by the essence of Dharma like fire hidden in a piece of wood. The Pandavas will now wage a war and destroy my foolish progeny. He knows of the consequences. Continuing, he says, O wise brother, the fear agitates my mind. Everything around me too is upset by the thought of an impending catastrophe. Guide me to the path of peace. Advise me how to quench my apprehension. Vidur replies, My faultless king, I do not see any other means of pacifying your apprehensions except erudition, tapasya, abjuration of greed and command of the five senses. A man wards of fear with intelligence. He attains to a higher level with the help of tapasya. Service of the Guru brings him knowledge. Yoga leads to the peace of mind. The persons looking forward to salvation do not depend on charity. They lead their life in this world giving up attachment, just lust, jealousy and greed. Rajan, those who sow seeds of disunity do not get a sound sleep, even lying on a well-made bed. Those who are inimical to each other never act according to Dharma. They can never be happy. They are unable to garner a good name. The practice of Dharma by you lies in unity of the family, treating everybody equally and fairly, justly. Vidur gives a very interesting and telling example. He says, slim creepers, daily nourished with water, withstand strong gusts of wind for years, for they are many and together. The same is true of noble and truthful persons. Individually weak, they are formidable when united. Unity is strength. Your sons and your nephews must unite, get together. They would be a formidable force against any enemy. O Bharat Shrestha, says Vidur, burning logs of wood emit smoke when kept separate. Members of a clan suffer when disunited and prosper when united. When a number of trees stand together in a grove, they can withstand the fiercest of gales. Like the wind overcoming the strength of a solitary tree, a man endowed with all the qualities, if alone, is considered an easy prey by his enemies. Maharaj, overcome your anger, which is born without sickness, which is bitter and causes a headache. Your anger is associated with evil. You do not want to give fair share of the kingdom to your nephews. Your anger is unyielding. Your anger is penetrating and hot, like an iron bar kept in a furnace. The noble persons gulp their anger, while the evil persons are unable to do so. The sick are always suffering, Maharaj. They have no taste for delicious fruit. Rajan, looking at Draupadi being won over in the game of dice, I had warned you. Kindly restrain Duryodhana engaged in betting in the court. The learned prohibits this type of behavior. However, you paid no heed to my words. Whatever is opposed to a polite temperament cannot be called valour. One ought to follow Dharma in all its fine nuances. Wealth earned through harsh and villainous means is soon destroyed. On the contrary, riches accumulated through gentle and honest means last for generations. Rajan, Dhartarashtra Pandavan Palayantu, Pando Sutah Tav Putransh Pantu, Ekari Mitra Kurvo Hayek Karya, Jivantu Rajan Sukhina Smriddha. Your progeny should protect the Pandavas, while the Pandava princes should safeguard your sons. The Kauravas must treat the enemy of the Pandavas as their enemy and look at their friends as their own. They ought to share the same aims, the same joys, and spend their lives in prosperity. Maharaj, today you are the cornerstone of the Kaurava Empire. The Kuru clan looks up to you for leadership. Brother, Kunti's sons are young. They have suffered terribly in exile. At the moment, for the sake of your prestige, look after the interests of the Pandavas. Sandhastva tvam Kaurava Pandu Putrai Ma, te antaram ripubha prathayantu. Satya sthita naradeva sarve duryodhanam sthapyatvam Narendra. O Narendra, kindly arrive at a settlement with the Pandavas, so that your enemies have no occasion to notice your weak points. Naradeva, the Pandavas' claim is rooted in truth. It is for you to restrain your son, Duryodhana. We wind up today. We shall take up another chapter from Vidura Niti in the next video. Thank you for listening to me visiting this site.